that.
Hello.
Is this a closed door meeting?
I thought maybe you didn't want to say anything.
I think
Levent, Ted, and I believe her Danny Bennett.
Danny Bennett's here.
And he's the owner of the property.
Thank you all.
And I'll turn it over to the attorney.
This is the owner?
Mr. Lipscomb, before I, just so you know, I am your commissioner. I want to do a lot of listening tonight to hear what you want me to do. I'm supposed to represent you.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so when we're doing this, if you will, please, let's keep it level-headed, calm. That way I can hear what's really going on. I don't want, and I hope everybody's on the same page so I know which road to take. If you're on five different roads, so many different directions, it really makes it hard to make a decision. So I hope everybody ends up at the end of the meeting on the same page and give me a solid answer of what you would like me to do.
Amen.
Okay? Thank you. Mr. Lipscomb?
Thank you, sir. Okay. Again, I'm Emory Lipscomb. I'm the attorney representing the applicant for an amendment to an existing planned unit development, which covers the property that you live on here, Bethelview Downs, and also the property which currently is zoned to a, which is currently shown on for the PUD as a commercial use. And what we are proposing is to, instead of commercial, to put a road in right here. The entrance on Bethelview is over here to the left of this. And these are townhomes, 15 of them, or 16, I believe. 16 townhomes that are proposed to be right here. This is the first home coming into Bethelview Downs on your left as you're coming in from Bethelview Road. That's the first home there. Then you would come on up here across this area where the pipeline runs, and you would come to an entrance here to the property which we're proposing be used for detached homes. These are all, there are 45 detached homes here and along this road right here. There'd be 45 of them. They'd be roughly the same size, maybe a little bit larger than the homes that are in Bethelview Downs, and would have brick fronts or rock fronts.
What are the size of those homes?
The minimum size, I believe, is 2,000 square feet.
On how big a lot?
On the same size lots that y'all are on.
One-fifth of an acre? One-fifth of an acre?
Well, I'm sorry, I can't tell you the acreage. I don't have them all here. They're the same size as y'all's lots.
What's the separation in those townhomes?
Again, be the same as what you have between your homes here.
It's in the townhomes.
Typically, townhomes are attached.
So there's no separation there whatsoever. So one fire could wipe it all out.
When you build townhomes or apartments, you build with a different level of fire protection.
Well, you build according to the code.
That's correct.
All right. And what does the code say about it?
I'll let Danny speak.
Yeah. You have to have a 1-hour firewall between every unit.
For every unit?
Yes, sir.
Okay. That's going to be maintained with
you can't build unless you go by the fire code.
They built a bunch of them in here without going by the fire code.
Not townhomes.
Mr. Lipscomb.
Yes, sir.
You are their legal representative. You're telling me that you don't know how many houses are going to be built on 1 acre. Is that what you're telling me?
I don't know that. No, sir.
But I think the density ratio, which you're looking at.
The overall ratio is about 3 units to the acre.
Three homes to the acre. No, sir, I'm talking about the area that's going to be built for residential purposes, not counting adjacent areas.
These homes here will be about 3 to the acre. 3 homes to the acre.
Mr. Lipscomb, may I ask you when that changed? Because we presented this proposal in front of the commissioners and in the public hearing. First of all, you said that the size of these homes were 1,440 square feet. No, tonight, you're standing
I didn't
there.
Say that.
Well, look back at your minutes. Oh, yeah, you did.
Yeah, I'd like to know.
And I'd like to know how many, if they're 2,000 square foot per home, how many do you plan to put
all
in there?
All of the 45.
And when did it change?
We'll have to have at least 2,000 square feet in.
Since when? Since the meeting? Because that wasn't what was said.
The application says 1,400.
Yes, it does.
But the 1,400 came off the existing zoning condition. Your zoning conditions for this development that y'all live in, the minimum is 1,400. That's where the 1,400 came from.
That may be where it came from, but that's the way you submitted it for a proposal.
Okay, I did submit that, and I can tell you that we did not intend on ever building 1,400 square foot houses.
That's not what your attorney said.
That's the minimum.
Who submitted it?
That was the minimum that was shown. We're telling you tonight that.
Are you talking about 1,400 excluding the garage?
Yes.
Yeah.
No, we're talking about 2,000 excluding the garage.
Excluding the garage?
Yeah, look, these lots would sell for $50,000 a piece. We're not going to build a 1,400 square foot house on them. It would work.
Why don't you redo your thing and say that?
We do, it says it right. We didn't redo it. We added this on here, and it's a zoning condition that we added to clarify, but I can tell you, I was out of town at the meeting. We never intended on putting 1,400 square foot houses on these lots.
Well, we know what intentions are. They really don't matter.
Right. This is in writing.
Let me finish my comment. So intentions don't matter a bit.
What matters is what the paper says.
That's right.
What the commitment is. And so far, have you made a commitment in writing that these will be minimum 2,000?
Yes, sir.
On official paperwork that the commissioners have.
Yes, I have, yes.
I'll ask the commissioners, do you have that?
I've had discussions with Mr. Lipscomb since that meeting. And I let him know that don't expect getting support from the commissioner, or at least this commissioner, unless these minimums are raised above what you all have. Since that time, I believe this is what they've come up with, and I'm hearing it also with you. And this is how we come up with conditions that everybody can live with, exactly like this. Saying that you didn't do it and you didn't do it at the time, it's kind of going backwards. Let's go forward and tell them what you can live with, what you'll be happy with, and if 2,000 exceeds most everybody's size house in here, it sounds like it may help your values.
Well, then you're saying to us, as our commissioner, you're saying to us, you will have a document in writing from them before that meeting that says the minimum will be 2,000.
Here's what happens. The conditions that get approved at any one of these things can change up to the moment of the vote, even by an amendment after a motion is made and a second is made. Somebody can then make an amendment to the motion. But I'm telling you that all these conditions that I'm going to hear tonight from you all that y'all want to see will get into the conditions that you will see scrolled before any motions are made.
So you're saying the 2,000 will be there?
From what if this is a comfort zone with you all, and it's not too big to fit on these lots, which I don't think it is, I've looked at it, I'm good with it if you're good with it.
But for what it's worth, this drawing, since this is a PUD zoning, this drawing will be, it will be site specific to this zoning. You can look at this drawing and the conditions are listed on this side. This will be adopted by the county, so you can all come and read this drawing, and it tells specifically what the specifications will be for these lots.
Does it currently say minimum 2,000?
Yes, it does, yes.
Why don't we have Mr. Bennett read those to everybody? So Mr. Bennett, will you mind reading all those?
You want to read them, Emory? You got a better reading voice than I do.
Yeah.
Okay. We start up here. The minimum house size for pod 8, which is the detached homes that we're talking about, 45 units of detached homes, is 2,000 square feet for pod B.
Minimum.
Pod B, which is townhomes, is 1,600 square feet. The proposed open space is 15%. The setbacks on the front are 20 feet. Side is 10 feet separation between structures. Each side must be at least 5 feet, but there has to be a total of at least 10 feet separation between the homes. And on the rear, it's a 20 foot.
Sorry, what did you say about the 5 and the 10 feet?
Okay, the separation requirements was taken off the final plat for Bethelview Downs. The separation in your subdivision is the same separation we're asking for, which is 5 foot and 10 foot between structures. And that was exactly what we is on the final plat for this subdivision.
I thought
so
that you couldn't have them that close together anymore because of the fires that occurred both here and north of here.
Here's what they done. The fire chief, because of the concerns, I'm for public safety, so I'm actually one went to him with it. And I asked them, what can we do to make that never happen again? One is, we don't put vinyl siding, okay? You will not see this Board of Commissioners approve vinyl siding ever again. You'll also see window this close, no windows can be across from one another, they are offset. Everything is a fire rated cementous material, even the eaves are on houses today, if they ever get this close. So all of these conditions will be in the final conditions, I'll make sure of that. As a matter of fact, I had the fire chief draw us up something that we can just insert every time that covers what they believe works.
Well, Commissioner, you know there's only one way in and out of there, our side.
I do.
This is going to put a tremendous.
That Bennett Parkway is.
Bennett, that's right. That's the only way in and out of there. We got two subdivisions dumping in it now.
Yeah.
This one and this one over here.
If you all remember what happened last time they had a fire, which everybody knows about.
Yeah, fire engines can't even get in there.
It doesn't matter what neighborhood you go into, when there's a fire.
What population do you put on the single highway?
I mean, it's a pain getting up there on.
It's just going to be.
But I'm whatever y'all want, but y'all got to understand it's already zoned commercial with 300 parking places over there.
At least that does not block or just, completely, I can't find the right word. It just overpowers the outflow that ordinarily would be there just from these two sections of the subdivision. You're putting another one, I don't know how many homes, but the very fact that you're saying that there's going to be X number of homes.
They're proposing it, not me. I'm listening. Yeah. I help you the questions.
Yeah, my concern is that's going to be a huge traffic problem, not just during office hours or getting in and out, but also when there's an emergency like a fire.
Sure.
We don't have an escape.
I'm going to try to answer your question the best I can, as neutral as I can. A lot of times I will show up at scenes of fire. I stay way back. I don't want to get in the way. But they show up with between 6 and 8 fire trucks and about 22 personnel are there. It's going to block up any neighborhood, any condition, any reason, because it's an emergency at that moment, and they're going to do what they need to do to put out the fire as quick as they can before it spreads to anybody.
Check with them. What's the maximum?
That's correct.
Yeah.
Whenever these zonings are put into place, I'm going to go through all, because I hear the same questions and comments a lot, and I've gone. Our traffic engineer department looks at these sketch plats, and if there is an issue ever, they have their numbers which they go by, and they will bring it up, and I will ask them point blank in the meeting, is this necessary for traffic study? Sometimes I ask them beforehand. If they say yes, then we hold it up and make sure there's one done. If there's not, they give us clearance, and it clears. They're proposing a total of 61 units, is that correct? So just in my head, I'm thinking if you have 61 units and there's 3 cars in the house, which sometimes is a little more than some people have.
Right.
But I'm going to go to the max, okay? 3 cars coming in and out once a day is going to be 6 car trips.
Twice a day?
So one car may go through twice a day, so we're going to go 12. Yeah. All right? 12 times 61. Can you help me? Well, 700 trips or something. Okay? 700 trips. Commercial, 300 spots, it may turn over 10 times a day, 5 times a day. Just trying to be realistic. If it turns over 5 times a day, that's once in, once out. 5 times 300 is 1,500, twice, is 3,000 trips. 700 in a residential potentially, 3,000 potentially in commercial. Where's the bigger traffic jam? And don't take my word for it. Don't run your numbers in your head, whatever scenario you believe is more realistic. I'm not telling you that's a fact. But run the numbers realistically, and where do you think you'll have your less impact?
Well, as a traffic, it's not going to be a rush hour.
That's exactly. Right. That's correct.
Staggered.
That's correct.
And not at the same time.
I agree. That's true, too.
Off over there all the time.
I have a good.
But we also don't know what commercial will go there.
Well, what I was going to say, if it's like the other shopettes that are on Bethelview, hell, there won't be anybody in the parking lot because half those things are empty.
Now, while the economy is down, you're very correct. And I don't know if offices go in there, then people show up at 8, 9 in the morning. It is a traffic hour deal. And some of them may not be, they may not be.
I don't know what truly could go there as commercial, and I don't know that y'all do either. So realistic, I don't do whatever y'all want me to do.
Well, that's true, but when we purchased these homes, we were under the impression if that developed, it would be commercial. Mm-hmm. And that was a big factor in buying a home in here, thinking there would be no more traffic added, no more children trying to get to school. And that it was not buildable for residential. It was not developable, Pulte said.
But I hear you.
And that's why we bought.
But please think about those numbers, though. I mean, really, we don't have to decide tonight. Go home and write down a piece of paper what you think realistic is for the traffic. When do you think it'll be heavy, when you don't? And just really sleep on it and think what truly, don't be hasty in your decisions. Whatever you do, you're going to live with.
Hold on. Wait a minute. Let's get some order here. This gentleman's been waiting to speak.
I'm sorry. You're talking about cars. We've got trucks on the other side.
And if you have commercial here, what will you have? More 18-wheelers?
Yeah, that's right.
I mean, you know, y'all need to make a decision, but you've got homes that people may care as much about the neighborhood as you do, walking their animals, walking their loved ones, and not speeding through here because they live here, or maybe not. Or you may have commercial where they're coming and going to business and they have no tie whatsoever to, and you've got 18-wheelers possibly coming in or not. But y'all need to think about all the scenarios that could be and what best suits you.
Well, we know.
The people that face Bennett Road now, I was looking the other night, just staring at it, and I didn't know how they feel. Should they have a say-so if they want to look at commercial stuff, looking back at them, and they have the big trucks coming down their road where they actually live all the time? Or would they rather have a neighbor across the road living the same style they do with maybe a little bit bigger house? I don't know. That's something y'all have to think about. Yes.
If you're rezoning, how is it that you didn't just rezone for single family, but you've got multifamily also? Well, so you've got two things.
But we're not rezoning. They're asking. We can tell them no. We can tell them, hey, put a space between them. Take a couple of the units out. Make room between them. That's what this meeting's for. What can you live with best?
Yeah.
What makes your home work best and your family life to work best?
But you're making the point.
Commercial.
We don't have any
family homes. But I'm going to need a hand vote because otherwise I'm going in five different directions and different opinions. And how do I know how to vote?
We can do a hand vote right now.
I get that. You just say live in commercial.
Okay,
what is the commercial zoning good for right now?
Is it pure CBD?
Yeah, it is. It's shown as CBD.
And is there any light industrial in it?
I think the big buildings that are shown there as you come in off of
where you're proposing townhomes?
Yeah, I think those, yeah, where the townhomes would be. Those appear to me to be warehouse type buildings there.
We're not building big trucks. That's what they have proposed to us. I just want to hear
that's what's there now. That's what's approved. Yeah, you can look at it yourself.
But you're continually saying, look at the number and the facts. But you're skewing it greatly because
I'm trying not to.
Let me finish my comment.
Sure.
In effect, you are, because when you talk about all those people who are going to move in there in the homes, almost all of them are going to be working. And we have big jams now,
right,
when all the workers come out between, say, 6:30 and 8:30. I mean, horrible. That's where that one big crunch of traffic, that's where the big crunch of traffic's coming from. Mm-hmm. In the other case, it would be spread out all over the day.
Yeah.
And that, to me, makes a huge difference in the comparison of what's happening in traffic flow.
And that's fine. I'm just trying to throw things out there for y'all to take home and think about.
Yes.
Go ahead, man.
Whoa. I'm not going to relive this twice.
Cut off.
Because I'm not standing doesn't mean I don't have the right to speak.
Would you like to speak, sir?
What I was told when I bought here was that was commercially zoned and it was a good place for a nursing home.
That's what I
retirement. That was the understanding I had when I purchased my home.
But that's not.
No problem with a nursing home being in there. Would I want more 18-wheelers like we've got at the end of Bennett Road? Hell no. How did the bank get a driveway on there? I have no idea. They should have never been allowed on there. My final comment is, regardless of what or if or how this is approved, you need a second access road.
Absolutely.
For this.
Yes. Yes. To get onto Bethelview.
Yes.
Sometimes you'll find that even if that access road gets a left turn lane, right turn lane, or some additional lanes to help you get in and out, it makes a tremendous difference too. I'm gonna go back and look at the plans that are in the widening project and see if that isn't part of it now. It may very well be.
We have the light now.
No, so, well, I'm not saying like you may have a right turn lane and may give you a left. I don't know what all the extra lanes they may be adding in there.
Well,
but let me touch on this. CBD is not senior housing or assisted living housing. Typically, it is not. It's a different.
It requires conditional use permit.
That's right. There'll be a different zoning coming up to make that happen. So, whoever told you that, the way it sits now without a conditional use permit, it can't be done. So, I can't tell you there, totally tell you the truth. Yes, sir.
Just a question. I'm personally relieved to see that the houses aren't 1,400 square feet. And, Mr. Hopewell, I understand you need to make some money on the lots, and there's very particular numbers you have to make, and I understand that. Just one question, one observation. I personally have a problem with the townhomes, multifamily.
Yes. Yeah.
And I see no green space, no amenities. Have you given any thought to maybe pool or tennis courts just to alleviate the congestion of multifamily homes and the traffic that brings versus maybe bringing something to the table and to the neighborhood by putting maybe a playground, just to kind of, you know, alleviate my personal concern about the multifamily homes there.
Okay, we have a green space requirement, which is exactly what was required of the subdivision that's in place now. This is all green space through here.
Could you put the big map up so everybody can see it?
Yes, ma'am. Yeah, we have this is all green space here. The intentions of this part of this.
Where's the road then?
Where is
the road?
Where's what road?
To the townhouses. Where's their parking?
Let me finish, okay, sir? Yeah. Let me finish answering his question.
Go ahead, man. I'm listening.
Okay. This is green space. These units will be looking at the rear of commercial. Like when this commercial, where this driveway is, these units will be looking at the rear of buildings.
Yeah, if that's where the bank is.
Just yes, that's where the bank is.
If you can just put your hand
where
the bank
right here's where the bank
driveway.
Is. Yes, this is the bank right there. The driveway is right here.
All right. Yeah.
Okay. if the townhomes are a problem, we can detach these units and make daylight between them. Okay. We would be willing to do that. Instead of having them attached, they would be detached.
Yeah, and again, the congestion, I think, is the thing. Well, it's multifamily. And also, just quickly, while I have the floor, you said the setback is 20 feet. Does anybody know what the setback on Bethelview Road is? Is it 30 feet?
The setbacks are the same as what's in this subdivision, with the exception of Pod B. This setback is 20 feet off the back of the curb. All these setbacks match what's in place in your subdivision. So, as far as Bethel Road, are you talking about Bennett Parkway? Or
yeah,
Bethel?
On Bennett Parkway, are those 20-foot setbacks?
Yeah, the same setbacks as what these houses
okay,
are.
Okay, so on the other side of the street with the 2,000
feet, it'd be identical.
Be 20 feet as well.
Yeah, it'd be identical to what these houses are. Our intentions are to match these houses equal or better. That's our intentions.
Townhome is
a house that's attached with a common wall. And if you, we will detach those units. If that will make you like feel better about it, we'll put daylight between those units.
And is the green space for the townhomes, or is the green space open for all?
This is green space through here is for the whole development.
And so there won't be swing sets and all that stuff back there?
We didn't intend on doing that, but okay. I mean,
where's the water coming from for that development? Let me just finish my question, okay? According to the original zoning, which is 2457, it identifies that for the 324 existing homes that Pulte built in here, that there were basically two water lines, a 12-inch line, which is west of Bethelview Road, and an 8-inch line on Bennett Parkway. Now, everybody in here, if you go out to your lead-in where your water comes into your house, you're gonna find a booster on it already. And what that does is that provides enough water pressure for you to get the tinkle of water that you get in your kitchen sink right now. According to the way this is zoned right now, we're not talking about any new zoning, that's the only water available for this entire property plus those 17 acres. So you're gonna take water from the existing supply to put into those homes. Am I correct or am I incorrect?
You are correct.
Okay, and there is no water anywhere else coming off of Bethelview Road, is that right? That's what I thought I read. The other thing I read, and I'll finish quickly as I can, is in the original proposition on those 17 acres, because of the terrain being so sloped, it said that if you were going to build house, I can't for the life of me see, I mean, that backs my land. I know it's a direct drop down, probably 20 feet. I can't understand, are you going to build on top of the hills? Are we going to have curved houses? Are they going to come down and ride up on the Bennett
Parkway? Where do you live at?
I live off of, right there. The third house
where
in off of the first. Right, come on down.
The third one,
yeah. That's it, that's me.
Right here?
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, there's no houses going behind you.
I fully understand that, but this is my community. I live here and I'm concerned about what's going out there. I think one thing that other people that I'd like you to explain, before I get to that, let me just say to you, in this original way that it was zoned, it recommends that you have water basins for storm water drainage. I don't know if you've incorporated that or not, but that's part of it, because of the steep sloping, that would be a concern, and that you would build detention structures to prevent runoff damage from rain. This gentleman's over here worried about green space. I'm worried about that because I know what that terrain does when it rains.
All right, detention requirements are not as function of zoning, they're a function of the UDC. And that basically says we have to detain the water and we can't, there's rules you go by. We're not asking, there's no way of getting a waiver from that. So in regards to detention, we would have to address detention just like any other development, just like your development did here. As far as the way we grade and the way it's going to look, we're going to grade exactly like what was graded in here for your subdivision.
If that be the case, and you want to tell me that you're proposing apples for apples and oranges for oranges, right. My question is this. Why are you not seeking to rezone this property right here instead of trying to build residential community on commercial property? I think the answer to that is you'd have to meet code, you'd have to do study of traffic, you'd have to do a lot of things, but why are we trying to put residents on commercial? Okay. Why aren't you trying to rezone to residential?
All right, from the standpoint, this is a PUD zone, okay? It's a planned unit development. It is unique in the sense that when this was done by Pulte, all the rules that's in your subdivision, they gave to the county, okay? That is the only zoning where you make up the rules as you go. So when they did the PUD zoning, all the setbacks, the 50-foot wide lots, everything that's listed in those conditions is what Pulte gave the county and the county approved it. This whole subdivision is a PUD zoning. We are not required to go back and rezone for residential because residential is allowed in a PUD zoning.
Not multifamily, sir.
Yes, it is.
50-foot lots where you're with us.
Yes, this is allowed in a PUD.
How many single-family homes do you put there instead of those townhomes? Maybe 10 instead of 16?
We would separate these and we could go to 15 with a separation.
What is the separation with?
Pardon me?
What is the separation with?
The separation would be 6 feet. I think you might get 10.
10 versus 16.
Yeah. But you got lots that are backing up to commercial.
Where's the road?
So these lots are different than all the lots from here back.
Well, that's 100 cars a day right there, just with that small change. Coming and going out of the one entrance, which is
going to
be a nightmare.
Okay, to answer your question, we weren't required to rezone. We were required to change the site plan, which is what you do in a PUD zoning. So this site plan that we have, if it's approved, it will be adopted in all the things listed on this site plan, which is, this is your site plan, this will be site-specific, and you will have to go by what's on this drawing. That's the only zoning classification that Forsyth County has where it's specific to the drawing.
And that has changed since this was first.
It has been clarified, yes, it has changed.
But as far as, won't you tell us, Mr. Bennett, all the things that's been clarified, my understanding, and I've been with you along the way here, is the size of the lot.
Okay, we'll clarify whatever you want to clarify.
What kind of houses are you going to have? The questions haven't basically been answered. What's the cost that you anticipate selling them for?
Are these lots are going to sell for $50,000 a piece?
What's the house going to sell for?
Usually, as a rule of thumb, it's four to five times what the lot cost is. But you can't build $175,000 house on a $50,000 lot.
But I mean, surely you've already come up with what you're going to do.
So, I mean, well, I'm going to sell these lots for $50,000 a piece.
And who's going to build them?
I'm not sure yet.
Is there going to be one builder?
We got to go by these standards. Look, the builder has got to go by the standards that's listed here that Emory presented, and it says no vinyl side, no aluminum side, and it gives specifications on what you got to go by to build a house.
May I say something if you don't mind?
Yes.
I don't know what the percentage is, but the majority of people that come in and buy land and develop it, a lot of them sell to the tract builders. They don't actually build the homes.
Right.
A tract builder, not always do they develop their own piece of land. Even if they do develop, they're not always the one that comes for the zonings. There are multiple people in the community that are always buying certain pieces of land, getting the zonings, and then they turn around and either sell it to the large tract builders, or the tract builder will also have them develop it for them. I don't know what the arrangements are financially. It's not my business. But it's not strange, but what happens at this stage of the game, because of that, all the conditions that we add, in addition to whatever he puts on his plans, you can put down brick or stone in the face of the house with no more than 20% of access.
That's on here.
It starts to create what the builder, when he comes in, has to build. They don't get to change the rules unless they come back to the Board of Commissioners, which I'm typically not favorable to doing when it comes to a design look, a design standard. Just to let you know how much I believe in design standards and hanging with them, for the first time ever, our district now has an overlay in it, which increases architectural standards, it increases the looks along the road, increases certain plantings along the roads and within the certain developments to give a better look all around the community. So I am a guy that understands all that, but if you choose this, you can set forth some standards that which you would like to see the homes built, so they meet or even exceed your homes. And hopefully, and if you choose this, then maybe it'll raise the value of your land or not. Y'all have to decide. And I'm gonna ask before we're done tonight, a hand of where y'all wanna be. Because just because somebody's a little bit louder, I can't follow what that little bit louder person was. I want what the majority wants, if that makes sense.
Well, yes, he made the comment he wasn't required to go for rezoning. But my question, thought is,
there's a lot of protections for us in the rezoning process. Absolutely. So why doesn't he just go through rezoning instead of the fast track other deal?
Unfortunately, the UDC allows him to do it, the law allows him to do it. However, let's add more conditions.
What protection would rezoning give you that you're not getting here?
I'm not familiar with all of them, but I know there are a lot of them.
Water is one.
No,
yeah,
water.
Traffic is number two. Any traffic engineer that comes in and looks at the traffic that's currently on there and knows the number of roads, the number of people that live here, the number of families, school buses, no sidewalks, everything that we've said to the county commission before, those are the things that we want you to hold in a veil when you build there. And without that property being rezoned, you won't do it. You can say you'll do it.
No.
You've already changed it, and this is our first meeting.
Listen, ma'am, listen. Yeah. I have clarified things because of all the confusion, okay? You've told me 3 or 4 times that I've changed things, and I'm telling you, looking in your eye, that I have, my intentions the whole time was to do what this drawing shows.
Well, if I had my
hold on a minute, hold on a second.
The original document, it says 1,440 square feet right on the document that's been submitted to the county.
And I explained that earlier. I took the square footage off your amendments, which is what your subdivision says you can look.
That's what you're purporting to build there. Now, so you've amended something, you've changed it.
Okay, I changed it and clarified it because But this was their intentions. We have not changed our regular, this drawing's the same. It's identical. This drawing has not changed. We have added some conditions on here that Mr. Levent can add in a separate document as zoning conditions.
What you saying?
Would you please let me finish?
I just want to ask you a question. Go ahead.
Well, can you ask it after I get through?
I can.
Okay. He can add those zoning conditions on as a part, just like a rezoning, he can add that as a part of this site plan amendment. The same exact conditions. It won't change the water. It won't change the way the streets are done. Nothing in the rezoning process has been circumvented. Okay, we've got to go by the UDC in regards to...
If we add those things in?
Can I please finish?
I'm not getting your point. Are you saying that if every criteria that we're worried about is added into that plan?
We can add it, and it's got, when we go to build these houses, the planning department will look at this site plan, they'll look at the new zoning conditions, and they'll make, everybody's got to go by that. They don't ignore them. It's part of this process.
It's a part of the approval.
It's part of the approval.
That's what's in the motion and the second, and if it's voted on by majority board of commission, It's set, they have to follow.
But aren't we about 7 days away from that vote? How much time does that allow for this community to come together and say, hey, we want you to look at these issues and put them in his document? Are you saying that you can do that before September 5th?
But putting stormwater detention in the zoning amendment is not part of it. We have to do that anyway. We're not circumventing that. We have to follow the stormwater management ordinance. We have to follow all the traffic guidelines in the UDC. We're not circumventing any of those processes.
There's a book about this thick, it's UDC, that's not shown here, but they automatically have to follow what's in the UDC. So when you get into all those concerns, the stormwater runoff and all these things, they have to follow
them.
There are also state laws they have to follow, but they don't have to list. It's just double listed.
The obvious question is, why in the heck are you so resistant to rezoning? There's got to be a reason. Why don't you just do it? Why are you so resistant? What's the problem?
If I rezone, I can't match your lots over here.
Yeah, you can.
No, I can't. No, this is a PUD zone, and your lots and your subdivision, I cannot match it in a rezoning.
Well,
because it's
feet. Can I match it now?
Yes, I am.
There's no,
yeah, well,
there are no townhomes on my street,
yeah,
sir.
Yeah, well,
you are not matching.
With the exception of Pod B, I am matching every
So you are not matching it. You are absolutely changing it by not rezoning. Now, who is the builder? I assume this was a track builder.
Yeah.
It will be a track builder, but I'm not sure.
So we don't know who the builder is.
Clear cut.
How long it's going to take for them to clear and build? This could go on for 4 or 5 years. Is that true? With lots not sold, and this guy's buying this one, and the stucco's here, and the brick's here, and this one's not done, and that guy goes bankrupt. And I mean, you know, it's not even a track deal, right?
No, sir. I've got 3 track builders that's looking at this piece of property, and I can't disclose who that is.
What is the concern? We just don't know.
You don't know, but
it's a huge question mark.
It's not a question mark with standards that you have to, every track builder would have to follow the same standard. That it's not a question mark in the sense that they have to build the same front, the same size house. It's all part of the rezoning.
Within 18 months, it'll all be done, hot-loaded, side by side.
I can't tell you that, no.
That's my point, you can.
Well, I can tell you that we'll be out of here in 18 months.
Well, with rezoning,
you said you couldn't say what size things would be.
It wouldn't have a lot. It would not match your lot.
Stop with the match. Stop that. If you rezoned, the rezoning would define what you could do, right?
No.
I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about if you rezoned, the rezoning would define for you what you could do there. So whether it matches us or not, I don't care. What it looks like when it's done being rezoned, I do care. And that would constrain you not to match us, but to do things in a right way.
No, the same way. What we're going through will be that exact process.
Well, then let's do it. Let's do rezoning.
But Mr. Bennett has told you that there isn't a zoning district that will allow him to match what you have here.
It's not matching.
Why,
there are no towns.
Why not match it? Because you can match it with the PUD amendment. That's what we're doing.
What about the townhouses? That
doesn't match anything.
Well, let's pull them out.
No.
pull it out.
Well, pull them out.
Let's put single family homes everywhere.
Pull out the townhomes.
Pull out the townhomes.
With the same 10 feet between, the same 12 feet between?
Well, on that point, for one second, a minute ago, when we were talking 10 feet, I heard somebody up there describe, but it narrows in some places to 5 feet. Did I hear that right?
No, it's not a total of five, it's a total of 10. On one side, it can be 5 feet, and on the other side, it'd be 5 feet, but it's not 5 feet separation.
That's matching Bethelview down setback.
Yeah, I'm just interested. So they won't be within 5 feet of each other?
No.
The townhomes will not be. What he was telling you earlier was if the townhomes were built, they would be closer.
No, I think he's misunderstanding. The home, any one home could be no closer than 5 feet to the property line with no closer than 10 feet between structures.
Also, the price point of the townhomes is substantially less of what anybody's house is in the subdivision. That's a concern. The fact that there's 16 of them smashed together as soon as you pull in is a huge concern to me. And I'm not speaking for anyone else, but if anyone shares that, speak up now. I think they need to leave.
I do.
Would you be willing to get rid of the townhouses and make them single?
He said so. 10 versus 16.
No.
Is what you said?
No. Right.
10
homes.
Right.
10 houses.
10 2,000-foot houses with a separation.
Would you be willing to do that?
What I would be willing to do would be to have separation between them. Detached and make the square footage 2,000 square feet.
No, residential
buildings.
We don't have.
No, it would be detached. There would be a detached house, and it would be a 2,000 square foot minimum, but there would be 6 foot separation.
But it'll be 2,000 foot.
2,000 square feet in that.
Townhomes.
Not townhomes. It would be detached.
Detached single family homes.
In 2,000 square feet houses. But there would be daylight between them, and there would be 6 feet of separation.
So in that case,
6 feet is too close.
Six feet
is too close.
Or lose two houses and spread them out.
I'm not the moderator.
Who's the moderator?
Hold on, wait a minute. Mr. Reese would like to have a question answered, please.
Oh, yeah, I'm
sorry. Now, you talked around, I think, this lady's question about retention ponds and water. What you're going to do there is add a lot of pavement, and that pavement's not going to absorb any water. So how are you going to handle the water? Where's the retention pond going to be? And eventually we know, because we're downhill from that property, that it's going to find its way to us. And it's going to be a lot more of a torrent than it is now, because we don't have any paving over there. So how, can you unpack that a little bit for us? Show us where you're going to...
If we do this, or if we do what it's approved for, we have to go by the Stormwater Management Ordinance for Forsyth County, which is a separate ordinance. That ordinance requires it requires 90%, if whatever the runoff is before developed, we have to be 90% of that number after we get through developing. And there's different structures you put in. There's they call them detention basins. And we have to put structures in and give reports that show we are not increasing the runoff, and we're actually decreasing that runoff by 10%. And that's got nothing to do with zoning.
So
that is an ordinance.
Where is it?
It would be in the low point. It'd be somewhere down in here.
In the quote green space.
Recreation.
But we still got to meet the 15%.
Yeah.
So
just put 8 homes in there instead of 16 townhomes, and it was good.
Yeah.
Is there any proposal in there for a clubhouse or anything like amenities like that for those houses? If you say that it's going to be price range of what, $200,000? If that be the case, wouldn't you, if you were buying a house like that, expect to have a clubhouse or something?
No, I wouldn't.
Well, then what's going to happen here? We're paying over here. They'll be jamming everything in the pool. And the tennis court, we pay for that.
Is that,
I disagree, because I think our HOA would have to vote whether or not we would allow them to use our facilities.
Yeah.
How do we stop them? We don't let them in.
If they don't have a card, don't let them in.
Right. It's just like the way we should be doing it now. If they don't have a card and they can't get in our facilities.
Opening their door again.
No, I'm not. Well, it shouldn't be happening. I'm not saying that it doesn't happen. I'm not naive.
It's like the federal government enforce the borders. And is that air conditioning able to be made cooler?
Yeah. I have a question, sir. Excuse me.
Yes.
Are the specifications building wise for the homes that are going to be put in here, insulation, R factor, is all that established?
By the building code, yes, ma'am.
And what is it?
The standard building code requires insulation, R values, that's all.
But incomparable to here, to these homes that are existing?
Yes, the code has been made more stringent. So, I mean, we're not circumventing the building code with the site plan amendment. They have to go by the same code that your houses went by, except the code has become more stringent since you built.
Okay, I got the water drainage culvert from the subdivision on the court in my backyard. And the slope to those lots over there is nowhere near that ski slope over there.
Excuse me, but where? Like, this is fairly flat here, and this is fairly flat.
No, it's not.
No.
Right.
No, I put a fence in.
There's a big hole here.
There's a huge hole there.
Huge. Oh, yes, behind the. Yes, behind.
But there's not 20 feet here for you to put a house.
You're going
to
grade
though. Yeah, we're going to grade.
It's huge.
Yeah, we will grade. Yeah. We will be grading.
I understand, but I don't understand how you can grade it to where the slope is sufficient not to cause erosion and.
There were slopes in your subdivision.
Yes, I know. I lived there.
Yeah.
In my backyard.
We'll do the same thing.
It's not a pretty sight.
We'll do the same thing.
You have a national pipeline going through there that you cannot bury. And that's got a lot of hills and dales to it. I mean, you can't just pile a lot of dirt in there because they have to get access to that.
This elevation will be about 10 to 12 feet lower than this elevation. So this grade change, this will go down, and it'll be lower. I said 10 to 12 feet, maybe 15 feet. But this elevation will be higher than that elevation.
Did you explore trying to get a separate easement road into this property so we don't have all this kludge? Because it's going to be a nightmare. We can talk about sizes of houses. We can talk about, townhouses or townhouses spaced or whatever. The fact of the matter is you're introducing hundreds of more residents on an already heavily burdened road. It's got tractor trailers on the front end, it's got bank traffic, it's got people waxing and washing cars coming in and out on the front end, school buses. Have you looked at trying to buy an easement out to Bethelview so we have a loop instead of a dead end?
That's where I'm going to go back. Now this is raised, I'm sorry I didn't bring it with me. I'm going to get access, I'll go get the plan, I'm going to go look at the Bethelview road widening project and see what they have going on for your road. They may already have it opened up and widened, I don't know. But I'll get you a copy somehow. Who's the person I could get it to?
Jim Floyd.
If you'll call me, I will get that to you, and if you can scan it and share it. I'm hoping it has turn lanes on it, which tremendously help traffic move. I hope it does.
But then we have a turn lane. That's not like
For either zoning, you stay with this.
That's not the problem.
That isn't the problem. It's the number of cars.
We have turn lanes already. The problem is that road curves, and you want to put houses on it. Other people coming out on the other side, and all hours of the day, when they're going to work and coming home, that's just dangerous. There are accidents that almost happen every single day because people park their cars there and you cannot stop them from parking their cars. That is not against the law. So they park, we have to go around. Once a week, I'm almost head on with somebody.
Traffic just to get around the car that's parked on the road.
Every day.
My question on that is,
excuse me a second. I was talking to Tim. I volunteer. I used to moderate business meetings, a lot of them. So I volunteered to moderate this meeting if you guys want me to, and then we'll have one speaker at a time.
No.
Would you like that?
I got enough bosses at home, man.
Was that, does everybody say no?
I think we're doing okay. I think we're doing okay.
Okay,
I'm the,
do.
I'm the property manager, Maury, so I'll do my best.
Yes.
Okay, one at a time, who's?
My command, or what I was questioning you, Mr. Bennett, is this, that the street that you came in on to get to this clubhouse is Turfway. Am I right, everybody?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay, and according to the proposition that's up there right now, that directly across the street on Bennett Parkway is where you're going to put the major and only opening that you intend to build, in that essence, another road. Am I right about that?
Yes.
Don't you see that as a very dangerous situation?
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. It's not any dangerous than all these. I mean, you got, look at all the roads you got coming off here. We're doing the same exact thing.
You don't like it.
That's in your subdivision. Exactly. We're not doing anything any different.
But we don't like it.
Okay, okay. Let him finish.
We're sorry about it.
But you're not going to be living over here.
Well,
You're good. Somebody else is going to be over here.
I'm always worried about leaving my home if I had to leave in an evacuation because of Bennett Parkway.
Okay.
Yeah, my primary concern is that there's only one entrance in and out of this development, mm-hmm. the existing one. Now we're going to add 45 to 60 more homes in there, still with one entrance in and out. Now, we've had a couple of fires in the 9 years I've lived here, and it was a nightmare. Two houses burned down, but if we ever have a major fire here in the development and the road is blocked because of the fire, you can't get out. So you could have, instead of two homes burning up, you might have a dozen or 15 of them catch on fire because you can't get out of the development.
The only thing I can say is there's fire ordinances in place, there's fire codes in place. We have to meet all the fire codes, all the access, ingress, egress. We have to meet or we don't build.
Well, why is it that Georgia only allows you to build a development one entrance in and out?
Yeah,
I'm from California.
I cannot answer that.
Every development in California has a minimum of two entrances.
So that
you don't get trapped.
Okay, yes.
How many homes are in Bethelview Downs?
270.
Almost 300. How many homes?
Between Haven and Port together.
Yeah.
Next question.
I just wanted to ask if you're going to put where Turfway continues straight over Bennett Parkway into the new area, if you're going to make that a four-way stop?
No, there'll be a stop sign here, stop sign there.
Okay.
So just a two-way?
Yeah, that's the question.
Ask her a question.
I'm going to point something out here. This is the court here. Now behind them you have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Are these all home lots here?
Yes,
sir. They
you live there.
I live right there. That's my house where you're going to build to the back of it.
Put 7 homes in that area?
There's no way. I walk my dog there every day. There's no way you can put 7 homes in that little space.
I used to walk our dog there before it passed 7 years ago, and I'm sorry.
Well, they'll do it.
Okay. Joan, you had a question.
Okay. Can't do it.
Second public hearing, Commissioner Levent said he thought there should be at least 15 feet in between the houses. That's what he said. And my second question is, on that road that you're going to put in that's going over the pipeline, it's sort of a ravine like this. Now, are you going to fill that in, build a bridge, and have you got approval from Atlantic Gas? Because it'd be a good skateboard park, because that's exactly how it's shaped.
If we get the zoning condition, I mean site plan amendment, then I will have to get Atlanta Gas's approval to do that.
To what?
To build this road. To build this road and to make the grades acceptable. There's maximum grades, there's minimum grades that the county requires.
But
we would not do that before we got the amendment, because if you kill this amendment, then we'll be in there, you know, on something else. This won't apply, so we wouldn't do that before we got the amendment.
And also, before the vote and the commissioners meeting next Thursday, is there going to be something written with everything you're saying before this vote is taken, so the residents of this subdivision can read it? Because what we have now is not what you're saying.
Yes.
And I would be happy to sit down. If you could pick maybe a half a dozen folks to represent that y'all feel comfortable with, or however many, whatever conditions Mr. Bennett has and he gives, we sit down with those, and we are absolutely allowed to add to that.
Okay, we've only got a few days and a holiday in between.
Yeah,
when
right.
are we going to find time to get people to do this?
I work till 1 in the morning.
Yeah, well,
I know.
I'm tired too.
I'm just teasing.
And I've done that. Been there, done that. But
you just look, whatever y'all tell me, I'll make time. I don't care.
No, it's not you, but can we get this done in the next 4 or 5 days?
And I have somebody in our office that I will bring in that is from our side of planning and zoning, or out of the engineer department, that will sit down in the meeting with us as well. You can tell them what your mindset is. They'll show you in a law where it already exists. It's not necessary to put it in there, or they will help you write the verbiage that you want.
So in other words, their application as it is now is not what they're saying.
I don't know about that. I'm just saying that we can add. It happens all the time. People all the time put in applications in a certain way they want them to be, and people get involved, and they always get changed. And that's why they only do sketch plats at this point in time, because these amendments, I mean, the conditions are always added to, taken away from, changed a little bit. And then
it's in writing before you vote.
Pardon me?
And it will be in writing before you vote.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
So anyway,
and we put it up, and it's on the screen inside the commission room, and the TV cameras are getting it. It's all recorded.
For everybody's benefit, is there any way to just push this thing off a couple
yes.
of weeks?
Yes.
If that's what we have to do, then that's what we need to do to get this wrong.
It sounds like that's what we
okay,
need to do.
Okay, let's not get out of... Okay, sir,
I know we're talking about the setbacks and gas lines, which is all important, but I'd just like to, again, bring home the biggest change, and the thing that's going to affect our property values the most is the fact that there's multifamily housing when you enter the subdivision. Now, as a buyer, I can tell you, I bought my home 5 years ago to keep my kids into Central, which lasted 2 weeks, then they went to South, and it was West and North. But anyway, if I pulled in and I looked and I saw multifamily housing, I would have done a U-turn and left the subdivision.
These are being attached in the same square
foot. It's the entry price of the unit. I am not going to live where the price of buying one of these things is significantly less than the price of my home. Okay? It's not what I'm going to do. It's directly going to affect the character of the neighborhood, and it is going to affect the resale value of my home.
So what would the industrial buildings do to the resale?
The industrial buildings are there.
There'll be new industrial buildings there. Right here will be in warehouses.
Well, it sounds to me that that will be another meeting, and I'm sure
that's
what would love to join that one also. I'm just telling you, you asked what our concerns were, this is my concern.
But I'm explaining to you, there will not be another meeting. It's already approved. There will be no other meeting.
The multifamily housing and those 16 units are going to be there.
Listen what I'm saying.
Commercial.
There's industrial warehouses in that pie that's already approved.
We're not to a point where we need to choose the difference between two evils at this point. We are discussing your plan.
But I'm trying to bring
you. I'm saying that there is my concern with your plan is the 16 townhomes as soon as you enter the subdivision.
But I'm telling you, I won't make these townhomes, and they will be detached.
How many?
They'll be 6 feet apart.
What's the sales price?
$225. Yeah, there'll be 2,000 square foot houses that match the same standards as this, but they're behind commercial. These are behind commercial buildings. Now, what I'm asking you, if you see this and your values, what are people going to say if there's two industrial warehouses right there?
They're going to love it.
I'm curious. If,
you know, I understand what you're saying, but
if this brings the values down, I'm just wondering what then. Well, these are houses in your subdivision, and this is in the subdivision. So those would be two industrial warehouses in your subdivision.
I just think it's a bad idea. Personally, I just like to see you put 7 or 8 houses there. I don't know why you'd have to do. It's a matter of making more money.
No, these houses back up to the rear of commercial buildings. They're going to buy, but they're going to be. These are going to be 2,000 square feet closer together than what these houses are. That's the only difference. These are going to be 4 more feet closer than what these houses are.
Make them all single family homes.
They are single family homes. That's what we're telling
single family homes.
They are single family.
The ones you have across the street.
Sir, these are single family. They're not multi-family.
Big lots.
Make them all big lots. Make them all big lots. The same size that you have across the street.
Yeah.
Across the greenway.
Across the greenway.
Yeah.
Or put a pool and a tennis court there. You know, you could put the regular size houses there.
I've looked at this plan, I've looked at the topography, I've looked at the water lines, and I've asked the same questions, have the same concerns you have. And to get into it, Mr. Bennett didn't touch it, those lots now, the way they sit with the townhomes attached or detached, whatever you want to call them, are 80 feet deep. The other houses are a minimum of 100 feet deep. That's where it comes in, whether or not he could fit those homes in like yours, like kind that you really want to do. Can the road fit between the property line and still get the depth he needs to get a regular house in before the topography drops off, or you get into the wetland area you can't touch? And that's kind of where I started to touch on it. But I'm still told now that I knew this was going to be an issue, mm-hmm. and that just try to get in your mindset that you're going to have to build like kind there as well.
Well, it sounds
and,
like
and, a good and I see that's where y'all have come to a head, and I see that's where it is. But
second access is the
and that's the other big issue. I'm listening to everything. I'm just
Mr. Bennett. Would you go over the part I'm not clear on what you said about AGL? Now, I called AGL, and AGL obviously has a 100-year lease on that property. They have the right in, they have the right out, they have the right to maintain it, and they're always going to do that. Are they going to allow you to build a paved road over that, which is part of the projected road, or not?
There's already a paved road over part of their easement. Yes, they will. That's part of the
and
easement.
And so what was your comment about what you were right here? What you were checking on with AGL's part, I didn't understand.
She asked if AGL had allowed or something about permitting through AGL. When we do this permit, we will have to give AGL a set of drawings that they will have to approve. The fact that we're crossing with a road is not unusual, and in our easement agreement with AGL, they have to allow us to cross it with a road. We still own the land, they just have a gas line there. So there's a road already here, and there's a road already here that crosses the gas line, so it'd be the same situation as what we have.
You can put a road there, but you can't build houses on it.
That's exactly right, yes. Mm-hmm.
And you can't go any higher elevation than what they've got right now?
Yes, we could.
You could.
But it would probably cost a lot of money.
It sure would.
Yeah.
Felicia.
How close can you build to, you know, they put a pump station there now at the end of that cul-de-sac where the empty one?
Oh, the gas line.
The gas, yeah, no, the there's gas a big ugly thing there.
Yeah.
So,
I think it's right.
How close, I don't know what else it calls ugly. So how close are you going to be able to put those homes to there? Are you going to have to lose some of your lots because of that?
This lot, I mean, this is blank space. I think it's on the easement. So it's within the easement there. So I mean, it's a moot point as far as this layout goes.
Okay, those people would live right next to that big ugly farm.
Yeah, because that big ugly thing is probably right in there.
Okay. Just wondering, I wouldn't buy a house.
We'll disguise it.
You can't touch
it. That might be where the playground might go.
I don't think so. Nobody wants to hear it.
You can't touch their equipment.
Okay, John.
Is the road that you have planned for the townhouses run parallel with the bank driveway?
Yes.
So you're going to build another road?
And you own that bank driveway, am I correct?
This is another road right there.
Is that a public road?
That's the bank's road.
Yeah.
No, it's not the bank's road.
That's not the bank's road.
So that will come out right across from where the trailer trucks come in and out?
Yes.
The first house.
No, across the street.
The first house.
There's a blank driveway there that nobody uses.
It's parallel to the bank exit.
Marty?
So this might not be a question for you guys, it might be for the commissioner. It's about what Bob's talking about drainage. What's going to guarantee that not one drop of runoff of that water from those homes ends up in our ponds? Because we've already had all of our fish killed from somebody screwing up over in the other development that they said that wasn't going to happen, and it did. Every time a cement truck dumps their load, we have gray water over here. And this pond over here is directly across from that property. So who do we see about that? And it might not have anything to do with what you guys are doing, because it might be something with the county.
We have to adhere to water quality. There's a water quality. The state of Georgia requires water quality, and we'll have to adhere to it's a state.
Where is your retention pond?
Pardon me?
Where is your retention pond?
It'll be in a low point somewhere in here.
I thought that was green space.
It is green space, but we'll have a pond right there.
And will that connect?
We're not going to build the pond. It'll be from here to there. It'll be like a small pond.
And where is it going to drain off into ours?
There's
across
a culvert
the street?
Right here. So you'll have, all this drainage is going on the road, so you'll drain where it's draining now.
But there's a big drain there that comes into ours.
It'll go where it's going to now. We can't put it anywhere else, and that's where it's going now. So
in other words, it would come into our pond.
Yep.
But we have to meet water quality standards for it.
So yes, who do we see in the commissioner's office just pick up the tab of maintaining our stuff?
Here's how it's supposed to work. The state has rules. We pretty much adopt them. Our engineer department monitors them. You pick up the phone if you think there's any kind of violations. They're out instantly. There's all kinds of what they call BMP's best management practice under state law, which we also make them follow. And whether or not it's the silt fences or other barriers, they'll have to have a structure. When he's saying structure, it's actually a pipe that comes up. It has holes in it, and it has an X amount of time frame in which it slowly drains and supposed to capture the silt within that area and only drain water out that passes the water quality. If you feel it's not, you pick up the phone, and the inspectors will come out and make them do what they're supposed to do. The problem comes in when people don't pick up the phone. When they see something wrong and it goes on for a period of time.
Yeah, they've been picking the phone up.
All right, but it's supposed to work. It can't taste magical. Unfortunately, the way water flows now is where gravity takes it. And there's no way to make it just magically evaporate. You know what I'm saying? But they do slow it down. It's supposed to drain down slowly. And it's supposed to filter that sediment out.
And when it doesn't, we get stuck with 100,000.
Whether it's residential, whether it's commercial, finally it's gotten established. I guess it was graded at one time. I'm seeing small pine trees back in there. So I imagine one time it was a problem as well.
Nydia.
Mr. Bennett, my name is Nydia Tisdale, and I see a corporate logo on your site plan called Contracting Engineers Incorporated. I've got a few questions about that entity. Is that entity registered with the Secretary of State of Georgia to conduct business in the state of Georgia? And the second part of that question is that entity registered with the Licensing Board for professional engineers and land surveyors to perform professional engineering services in the state of Georgia? And I believe, sir, you served on that board at one time.
The answer is yes and yes.
And why is that information not available online on the Secretary of State website?
Maybe. I'm not sure.
And when was it registered?
I'm not sure.
So that corporate entity is registered and licensed to perform engineering services in the state of Georgia?
Yes.
And who is the professional engineer associated with Contracting Engineers Incorporated?
Me.
And you are currently licensed?
Yes.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, fine.
This water issue has a lot of, quote, forgive the pun, downstream implications. Marty mentioned it. When these retention ponds fill, we have to pay to get them dredged, and that's hundreds of thousands of dollars. I recommend an escrow account so that these guys put some skin in the game, since they're going to be affecting our drainage, so that when it does come time, we're not footing the full bill.
Is there possible to do a bond on something like that?
No.
Yeah, Pulte did it.
I'll ask my engineer.
Pulte did it.
I'll ask her.
I mean, you, when I say no, I'm saying we would just develop it commercially before we would put it in an escrow account.
Well, that's a good idea.
Yeah. I think it's a great idea.
Yeah.
I think we'll have the commercial. Another meeting for another day.
Commercially, we still have the same detention requirements. It's basically the same, like we still drain into the same place. It's just more pavement. The commercial will have a lot more pavement than what these houses will. So it's, you mean this is very forgiving on pavement in impervious area compared to the commercial.
Chuck, did you have another commercial question? Sorry, did you have another question?
I heard a couple of questions.
A second ago you said no to the recent question. Then you said, oh, well, we could. So the answer wasn't no, you just wouldn't do it. My question is, you said the two things that she mentioned, your guys were approved for the state and all that, you said yes they are. If it turns out they're not, would you agree you got to start over on this project?
Yes.
Okay. Why is your signature not on the site plan, and why is your professional engineer's stamp not on the site plan?
It's not required.
It's not required by whom?
UDC.
What about the state of Georgia?
It's not required by the state of Georgia. In fact, the state of Georgia, this is not a design plan. Engineer seals is all to do with design. That's how you get one. This is not a design plan. It's subject to design, and it's not required to be an engineered drawing.
It says site plan, sir.
It says it will not be an engineered drawing.
It reads
says
site
that specifically. That it will not be an engineered drawing. That's in the UDC. So why would an engineer put his seal on a drawing that's not engineered?
So this drawing has not been engineered?
It's not required. This is a concept drawing subject to design. Yes.
Who drew the design? Who drew this drawing?
My company drew this drawing.
Your hand or whose hand? Who prepared your drawing?
We're about to get way off base here.
That's a simple question. Who prepared the drawing?
Can I answer the question?
Yeah, he did.
Okay, we've got another question right here.
I've answered every question.
We went to the same load of questions on the zoning board. Ms. Tisdale brought this up in another zoning recently.
I think another
and,
three
and a planning commissioner made a comment in a meeting specifically that said that it shall, but he kept ignoring the words etc.
Yes.
And in a meeting I was concerned, so I clearly asked our director of planning and zoning if it's required at this stage, and he said no, the concept plan sketch plat does not require it. I then turned in the open meeting to our legal counsel. I said, well, do you concur? And he concurred. At this stage it does not, because any zoning conditions that we ask to be changed or do get changed, however, will change how this gets ultimately landed. And they don't require that large expense at this stage or in the concept stage of discussions and molding and shaping a zoning for it to have be done at engineer level, and the stamp is not required until that stage. And once it gets past zoning, that just starts to go through all this extra scrutiny, additional scrutiny from all the departments, including the engineering, including the soil stuff, including the roads. All these things start to come into play. You will also find, maybe not in this, but in a lot of neighborhoods, once we give zonings for a certain amount of lots for a certain density, you will also find a lot of times they don't get the amount of lots they thought. One, because of topography. Two, because of additional state waters that are found, that weren't found. It gets much more into the deep weeds of finding things and much more detail after the zoning stage. It doesn't just fly through like this all the way to the end. It goes through all of our departments for a lot of scrutiny. It's just what happens. There's a lot of laws in the UDC that they have to follow, and state laws they have to follow that aren't on this paper at this time, because we already know they're set in stone in our laws and in our UDC. Our UDC is part of the county laws for zoning.
Okay.
If that helps understand any of that
sure.
at all.
Yes. Okay, we have a question.
This lady over here mentioned something that concerns me, and that is our water pressure.
Absolutely.
Now, how can you cure that, or is it going to affect that? Because we don't have very good pressure.
Where is it? In the whole subdivision or certain spots?
Well, it certainly isn't my house. I don't know about everybody else.
Where's the low pressure at? You know, like
low pressure at my house.
Yeah, where's your house at on here?
Okay, I'll show you. You want to look at the big map?
You see
where
you're not on this
Wayfair.
Oh, 1, 2, 3 down. Yeah. Oh, you're up there. Does your neighbor have low pressure?
Yes, my neighbor.
And I'm next to them.
Do you have low pressure?
All of us do.
Do these people have low pressure?
I know.
You know what the question is? You seem to have a lot of stipulations, a lot of percentages Mr. Lipscomb does too, as far as traffic flow, impact, so forth. Have you actually done an impact? Because again, identify. There's only two places that you can pull water according to the original zoning for this property, and you honestly admitted to me that you're not going to get water from anywhere else. So if you're not getting it from anywhere else, you're taking it from mine. So can you identify for me what percentage my water reduction pressure is going to be reduced as a result of you putting 61 homes in there?
The only thing I can tell you is we have to meet 750 gallons per minute on. I actually think that there's a zoning condition that may be a little higher than that. We have to meet the gallons per minute flow rate required for fire protection.
Can you exceed it? And
we can exceed it, yes. But we have to meet that to be able to put these houses in there.
But that's the hydrant system you're talking about. That's not potable water.
But the hydrant system is potable water, yes. That comes from the same line.
So the same line.
It is, yes.
So
only in Georgia.
So we have to meet a certain gallon per minute at 20 pounds per 20 psi to be able to put these houses in there. As far as what that does for your water, I'm not sure.
Well, if we're having problems with it now,
yeah,
and you can exceed it, why don't you just go ahead and do that? It's going to cost you more money, but we're not going to have to worry about our water pressure being even lower than it is now.
Well, no, when you ask me if I could exceed it,
yes,
that means if I have more than that, I can exceed that value. As far as physically making it exceed,
no.
I don't know that I can do that.
If I may say something, now that's concerned about the water has come up, I'm not 100% sure. How many folks here believe they have low pressure in the house? Well, no, I don't think so. That's what I was trying to say. It looks like about a third. This is something I'm going to go back to the director of the water department and say, hey, would you mind going and take a look and see what in the world's going on? And there could be multiple different things. Yes, they can have an issue with that. There could be a valve of their own that's not opened all the way in a certain area of the neighborhood that's not allowing the water flow correctly. It could be your pressure regulator in your house is not adjusted correctly. I'm not telling you to touch that. If you're not a licensed plumber, you shouldn't touch that, because that's in there so you don't put too much pressure in the pipes in your house and cause any damage. But there's multiple things that could be the problem, because not everybody has it. It's isolated.
Well, not everybody is here tonight either.
Boy, that's for sure. That's a small reference.
That's what I'm getting at. See, so this is different than overall.
But like I said,
how would that affect what you intend to do?
If I
contracted buildings, or would you change the plan, or say maybe I'm going to put less houses in, or I'm going to get a new different builder, or no reason.
There would be no houses. If I can't meet the fire flow pressure, there would be no houses put in.
But you don't know if you can or if you can't right now, or you know you can't?
No, I don't know if I can or I can't.
I'll get an answer from the water department why they believe there's an issue. And they may say it's a line, they may say it's not the line. It may be, like I said, y'all may be in one valve in an area. I don't know if all y'all live in the same area. No. One valve's not all reopened up. Maybe the regulated valves in your house are not adjusted correctly. Or maybe it's a county issue at large that the county needs to fix so they can reach what they need.
I'm pretty much familiar with a lot of low pressure places in the county, and I would not expect this to be a low pressure because Bethelview is a main thoroughfare and there's just major water lines out there, and I can't imagine why you would have low pressure this close to Bethelview.
Barely enough. Yeah. Barely enough to take care of the house.
And maybe sometimes, you know, if you're on a high hill or you're going up in elevation, but that, you know, that shouldn't be, you should be okay there.
I hear you saying you're gonna meet all the needs for that area right there with water.
We have to.
I understand that, that's good. But if, while you're doing that, it has the effect of reducing ours in some areas significantly, that's not your problem, right?
The county should step in. Yeah. The county shouldn't allow that to happen. The county should take care of what water pressure is necessary in this area, especially if they're approving this.
Yeah.
I mean, I can't imagine why some don't have and some do have water pressure. There's something different going on than just not enough water coming in the area. Somebody's valves are not adjusted right. Let me get them out here and let them start researching this to find out what it is. Hopefully they can resolve it for you now, whether this happens or not.
Well, it sounds like with all we're talking about that we're definitely going to have to move the decision meeting out
to something. That's fine.
Maybe 3 weeks or something.
And we do it by two because that's what our meetings are.
4 weeks.
So if we move it, would it be 2 weeks for a public hearing or just a comment?
No, there won't be. There's no more public hearings on it allowed according to the UDC. That we've reset for this to meet the law. And then we had the one, well, there may be one more for the county. I'm so sorry. Yeah, there is. There's one. But let me make my phone calls first. I have a contact with you. I need to find out. I want the water department to come out here. I want all the other issues that y'all brought up tonight answered. I want an engineer to take a peek at this. I want some questions answered, engineer for your traffic. So we have all these answers for you already. If it takes 4 weeks, it takes 4 weeks. But it may not. I may have these for you really, really fast.
The reason we're having this public hearing next week is because no one posted the second one.
Correct.
Which was
I'm sorry, you're correct. No, you're correct.
And that's
well, I don't know if it's fraudulent. I'm not going to say correct that, but
well,
something happened.
The date you have a public hearing.
That's correct. Something slipped through the cracks. I'll give you that.
Right. And after you said to me at the meeting for comments the other night.
Yes, ma'am.
I drove in. When I left the subdivision at 4:30, it said July 2nd.
Right.
When I drove in at 6:15, someone came and put a new tape on with that new date. So they knew they were wrong, because while that meeting was taking place, somebody went out and changed the date.
Well, they probably knew what my intentions were when I heard all the comments to make it done right.
Because within an hour and a half, the time got changed.
Yep. Let me get all the answers from the county based on all of y'all's questions and concerns and see how far we need to move it out. Okay?
But we still have the public hearing and not just the comments, correct?
As long as we can read, if we're going to have the public, that's correct. Then we can leave the public hearing where it is because it's been legally advertised and announced.
But then if we don't get all the answers when we go back in 2 weeks, then we can only comment.
But you would have sat down with me a lot of times, and we would have made that list y'all want.
Yeah, we have a huge population here.
But I'll come back, and we can sit down here. And
there's a lot of issues.
Okay, why don't we do that?
Absolutely.
Why don't we schedule you to come back?
It doesn't necessarily have to be a open public meeting if you don't want it to be. Y'all advertise within your own community, since you're the concerned people, is right here. And anybody else that's here that's from outside of the community that came because of the signs, if they want to get on your list, which they've signed in, so please contact them as well. So anybody that's concerned will come.
Lisa, you had a question.
I had a question for Mr. Bennett.
One more for Mr. Bennett.
Mr. Bennett?
Yeah.
So you said if you can't get the proper water flow that you wouldn't be building any houses.
They would not allow me to build.
Does that also mean you couldn't build commercial, so you couldn't build anything?
Yeah, that's right.
Probably right. Yeah, for fire protection, yes.
Okay, another question here.
If you don't go through with this plan and it stays commercial it stays a commercial hub, will there be any more public involvement?
No.
Who answered that question?
I have a question.
Did
you say no?
I said no.
Yeah, they'll just build.
He's the one that can answer that question, not you.
I'm sorry, I didn't hear the question.
Excuse me. Just a second. He's still got a question.
If he switches back to, if he doesn't go through with this and stays a commercial HUD, will there be any more public involvement?
No. I mean, it's already zoned. It's done. Okay. It's done. It just goes through the way it's already set.
That's a good idea. That was partially my question, because I know getting back to my development where I live over here on Waveland, when I first moved here about 12 years ago, Pulte told me, that they wouldn't be building in the back. Also, I had to have my property resurveyed on two or three occasions at my expense. Reedlow, Pulte. That is why I put the trees right on the embankment, okay, because they had made a mistake in my property, so I had to have it resurveyed at my own expense. So I just wanted to have that clarified. He said maybe, but you know, I like a definitive answer.
What did I say maybe?
As far as what are they gonna do if this doesn't go through, maybe, or what?
No, this doesn't go through, it will be developed as what it's approved for.
So you're going to develop it commercially?
Yeah, if this doesn't go through, it'll be developed commercially.
But if it's because of water, you had said a few minutes ago that you wouldn't be able to build anything on it.
Yeah.
We got to meet fire flow for commercial or residential.
Exactly.
I'm going to bet money that we meet the fire flow. I mean, I think we're going to meet it.
Bob.
Am I correct in understanding that for every tree that's there now, you have to replace it with a tree, because you're going to have to knock down a lot of stuff to do earth.
If it's a specimen tree, we have to replace it.
Specimen tree, what does that mean?
Over 18 inches, big old trees, not pine trees. Well, I mean, that's already been clear cut. So we would have to meet a tree ordinance and plant trees, but we wouldn't have to replace it unless it's a specimen tree.
So
we do have to plant trees according to the tree ordinance.
Okay, but most of those trees in there are pine trees, so they're not considered specimen trees.
They're not considered
specimen.
All those
are going down. And see, I've lived here 9 years, and back up to all those trees, not only the beauty of the trees, but the buffer of the noise. It's going to be like I live right down there off of Bethelview. I might as well live in that car wash.
Where do you live at?
Oh, I'm one of the famous people in Wayfair Cove. No, actually.
Oh, right here.
Go to the left a little bit. Not that one. That one.
Yeah. This one?
Yep. Lot one.
But
that's me.
With all due respect.
Yes.
Okay, there's going to be more trees here. I need to be careful, make sure I'm telling the truth. If this gets developed commercially, there's going to be more pavement, okay? That's a given. There's going to be 300 parking spaces out there. The trees would be more aesthetically pleasing if it was in the house, because they will make us plant trees according to the tree ordinance. In either circumstance, commercial or residential, we have to meet the tree ordinance. So, under any circumstance, whatever you're seeing here is going to be gone. It's not going to stay there like it is.
Hootie Owl isn't going to be there anymore, huh? The Hoot Owl.
He may be there, but he's going to either be living on somebody's front porch, or he's going to be living in a commercial building.
Yeah.
One of the two.
Okay.
Deborah.
All
right.
That's a real big concern. Because the land, again, point out, you said before, I live in that third lot. Okay. That drop off goes like this.
Yeah.
Behind my house, but then it comes straight up about 20 feet. Now, were you going to go in there and clear cut everything back there? Because you have to go out there with the bulldozer to get in there.
Look, right.
It's not necessary.
We're going to do this right here. there's your house. We're going to do that.
That's fine.
Okay, if we can do that, then we can have a house there. You understand? This is the way it's zoned now. We got two buildings right behind you. These are commercial buildings. We either got one house or two commercial buildings. That's where we're at. Either one house or two commercial buildings. I want to build a house. That's what I want to do. So,
it answers the question. You're going in there, square cut everything.
Well, we won't tear cut.
There's a lot of area out here.
Under this scenario, yes. Under
no,
this scenario.
I'm talking about under your scenario.
I don't think we would clear cut everything. We'd probably do this. We'd probably be left intact. It would be enough to fill this hole up, and then that would be left intact.
So are you going to bring Phil in?
We're going to get Phil from down here.
Wow.
That's why I'm going to remind you, may change again. We'll do this again. As it stands now, who wants to see it stay as commercial? Please put your hands up.
What, commercial?
Commercial.
Oh, absolutely. Commercial. Absolutely. Commercial. Absolutely. Commercial.
Don't want a commercial.
Everybody.
Now let's go residential. Everyone residential.
Without townhouses.
Or at least 10 feet between with the same square foot limits.
And another room.
All right, so, and I don't know about the 20 folks that left LA. Please come back when you get your emails. Please come back. It's just better to have everybody participate. It really is. It helps me understand where everybody's minds are, not just a few.
Just make sure everyone signed the sign-in sheet.
You did commit to putting off the meeting.
I'm moving it out at least 2 weeks at this time. I asked to move it out 2 weeks at this time. I have to get the votes of the board to do
sure.
So. Just know it. And I have to make sure we've got the time frame to do it.
Sure.
But we may still have the public comments in the public hearing in 2 weeks, but we'll hold off the vote for additional meetings and get all the
So you mean in a week we'll have the public hearing?
We'll stay where it is, but we won't. I'll ask to postpone the decision for at least two more weeks so we make sure we get all the conditions.
Why can't we put a public part off as well?
Because I'm not sure you have enough time legally to move it with resetting it.
Oh, because of the notice thing.
Thank you.
Thank you. That's right.
All right.
You're going in circles.
Okay. Yeah, you cannot. You can't build a house on top of the gas line.
Okay, but so you're gonna have to leave land space in between.
Where, yeah, it'll be a backyard. It'll be a set.
Right. Yes.
Okay. And you can look on the plan and see that. But you got to understand, that is a different part of the subdivision. It's entirely different. We can't treat it.
I compromise.
I compromise.
and then he didn't.
I wanted to go 1,800, but I think I could go 2,000. I know it's a good but I think I could go 2,000. Well, ma'am, I'm being honest. Like, it'll be written down. We went over that.
We vote 2,000, but now you're saying
I can zoom that in and see what it says. He told me that he bought this property 6 months ago or 8 months ago. He's trying to determine if that's going to get on to his next project.
Some of them may be 8 years. In front of a place to commercial.
We'll face
the back of the commercial.
My concern with the rentals is that the union is